Hello and welcome back everyone, we Weeb Online, and today I'm gonna continue the story What If Naruto Became the Dark Emperor Part 2. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a big thumbs up, and to watch more videos like this, subscribe to my channel and turn that bell notification on so you never miss an upload. Now wasting no more time, let's begin.
Fire Country, Konohagakure no Sato, the Konoha Exodus, in which four of Konoha's most prestigious clans defected from the village hidden in the leaves, had been a week. 5 years ago, the village hidden in the leaves was thought to be the most powerful of the Shinobi villages. It was a village that commanded respect from friend and foe alike, with the most powerful of the Jinchuriki as a deterrent in powerful clans such as the Hyuga and several others. Then, Sasuke Uchiha tried to defect to Orochimaru, but was stopped by a teammate and returned to Konohagakure no Sato. The tribunal that had pardoned the Uchiha and exiled the Uzumaki then arrived. Shikamaru Nara, Naruto's father, the parents of his two teammates, and Hayashi Hyuga all spoke up in his defense. Because the Uchiha had broken the law by using the cursed seal to combat Naruto, he was forced to use the Nine Tails' power in retaliation. The law stipulated that Sasuke Uchiha, not Naruto Uzumaki, should be exiled. Surprisingly, Anko Mitarashi, Ino Yamanaka, Choji Akamichi, Hinata Hyuga, and Selgai defended Naruto. However, they were ignored, and Naruto was exiled. When those who supported Naruto protested, Tsunade and the council threatened to deprive the four clans of clan status, to which the Hyuga and the Ino Shikacho responded by threatening to leave Konoha, further crippling it. Tsunade and the council were forced to back down. The events following the Uchiha retrieval mission became known after both the Uzumaki and the former Hyuga heiress fled Konoha. Things had gone downhill from there in the months that followed. Suna was the first to withdraw from the alliance formed with Konoha and Fire Country. Gaara had heard from Temari that the Ino Shikacho and Selgai had spoken up for Naruto and approved of their actions. If they decide to leave Konoha and move to Suna, they will be very welcome. Wave Country quickly followed, canceling trade agreements with Konoha and Fire Country. Second, a scroll was delivered by Spring Daimyo Koyuki Kazahana. Spring Country was not only terminating its trade agreements with Konoha, but she was also pulling out of the Ika Ika film due to headache and Jiraiya's intimate betrayal of Naruto. She also threatened Jiraiya and Cell 7 with death if they returned to Spring Country. As Jiraiya would later discover, once the Empire was established, the Spring Daimyo would star in a series of movies based on Murasaki Shibaku's novels. Spring had left the Empire with a trading alliance for her homeland as a bonus. The same thing happened in the other countries where Naruto made a name for himself. Once they discovered not only the circumstances of the banishment orders, but also the relationship between Naruto and the two Sannin, treaties and alliances were formed. His godparents orchestrated the betrayal. A family betrayal. Finally, Konohagakure became known as a village that exiles heroes and rewards traitors. The Fire Lord, as well as the village and the two Sannin, are synonymous with the word hypocrite, whereas Kakashi Hatake, the majority of the clans who supported the banishment order, and Sasuke Uchiha himself are synonymous with the word traitor. Even Iwa, who despised Konoha, was taken aback by how their most despised enemy's son was treated. Despite the Stone's long-standing policy on Jinchuriki, they would have expected the Yondaime's son to be treated better. Despite Tsunade dispatching Shinobi and ANBU to search for Naruto and Hinata, nothing was heard from them after 2 years. Then came the Western rumors, a place so war-torn since the Six Paths era that not even the Akatsuki would venture there. The West's wars were finally over, and the lands were united under the rule of a single ruler and his wife, Empress Consort and Emperor. Then merchant houses appeared in Spring Country, Wave Country, Wind Country, and a few other minor countries. According to several traveling merchants, Asuma met while attending the Chunin exams with his nephew's team in Suna. The mercantile guild was known as the Pekara Merchant House, and it had originated in the West, now known as the Unified Western Empire. The Emperor and his wife, the Empress Consort, ruled it. "From what I've learned, the Emperor is just a kid," Asuma said. He was only 14 when he killed one of the more powerful warlords and united the Western lands under his rule 2 years later. His wife, the Empress Consort, is a medic nin and oversees the Imperial Medic Program. The Pekara merchants spoke highly of him. "He is loved by the people and respected by shinobi and samurai alike." Sasuke Uchiha was dissatisfied. Jiraiya then reported that the Jinchuriki were disappearing a year after Asuma's report. Ujito Nai was the first, but she vanished around the time Naruto was exiled. Then came word that Iwa had misplaced their Jinchuriki. Not long after that, Anbi were deposed by Pro-Oto forces and disappeared. Fu from Taki had vanished, as had the rogue Miss Ninja Yudakata and his student Hotaru. Tsunade and Jiraiya suspected the Akatsuki had taken them, but in the back of their minds, they suspected the Unified West, because Jiraiya had learned from his spy that the Akatsuki did not have any of them. Gaara, the Kazekage of Suna, was the only Jinchuriki left in the elemental countries. Second, as Konoha discovered when they attempted to send a force led by Kakashi Hatake to force Tazuna, and the Wave Council to re-establish relations with Konoha and change the name of the bridge from the Great Naruto Bridge to the Great Uchiha Bridge. They arrived just in time to see the bridge detonate from the multitude of exploding tags, separating Wave from Fire Country once more. The Konoha Shinobi returned home, disappointed. A high-ranking official and his wife, a man dressed in black, were also known to conduct inspection tours of the Pekara Merchant House branches in the east. Konoha jumped at the chance to learn more about the mystery ruler and his wife. Danzu Shimura dispatched two squads of his elite Rude NBU to find the emperor and his wife. He hadn't considered that the man in black would have a crack team of shinobi and samurai bodyguards protecting them. Jiraiya had come along from the shadows to watch in awe as eight warriors ripped apart 12 of Danzu's elite Ni forces while the man in black and his wife sat back and drank their tea. Much to Jiraiya's chagrin, the man's face was obscured by a black cage-style hat, and the woman's dark bangs obscured her eyes, making identification impossible. Danzu was enraged. The Ni he'd sent was the best of the best, and the elite guards, the mystery man's bodyguards, had easily dispatched them. Jiraiya had informed the council that the elite guards were as skilled as, if not more so than, their Tokubetsu Jounin counterparts. 6 months later, Jiraiya received word from his spy network that Orochimaru had been spotted lurking near the Fire Wind border with Kabuto, inspecting the Pekara outpost, which was located about 5 miles inside Wind Country. From the shadows, he saw Kabuto and Orochimaru get their asses handed to them by someone he recognized as the commander of the Man in Black's bodyguards. When Orochimaru summoned Manda, she responded with her own summon, a massive, seven-headed serpent even larger than Manda. Orochimaru, Kabuto, and Manda had to flee. It was then decided that Hatake, Yamato, and Sasuke Uchiha, the latter having been taken as an apprentice by Danzu, were Konoha's best bets for obtaining the necessary information from the mystery man. Jiraiya's intelligence network had tracked the man in black to Tea Country, where one of his elite guards was competing in a taijutsu tournament. The man in black was well known by this point, so much so that a group of S-class missing ninja from Kumo and Iwa attempted to kidnap him for ransom, and had also tracked him to Tea Country. And, as Kakashi, Yamato, and Sasuke witnessed, the man in black was a skilled fighter, as he easily dispatched the S-class group of missing nin. Missing ninja could cause serious problems for Konoha. Even better, he did it all without breaking a sweat. According to Kakashi and Yamato's reports, Sasuke was the first to initiate combat, followed by Kakashi and Yamato. Despite the fact that Sasuke and Kakashi were both wielding the Sharingan and Yamato was wielding the Makoutan, the man in black had brutally beaten all three men. The man in black had punched Kakashi through a tree, making his situation the worst. Yamato was ruled out due to a broken leg, leaving Sasuke to face the man. Sasuke was the only one who knew who the man in black was. The Emperor of the Unified West was the man in black. Tsunade had rescinded her orders to bring the man in after Jiraiya confirmed it, as the last thing she wanted was a war that could easily spell disaster for Konoha. The council, however, was not persuaded, and there was a group of Pekara merchants in the village. Tsunade summoned one of the merchants for questioning, deciding to hear it from the horse's mouth. Council chambers in Konoha. Sachiko Asahina, a former Konoichi, was the merchant in question. Following the unification war, she had left her unit at the age of 27 and joined the Western Empire's intelligence division, which eventually led her to the east, with Fire County as her assignment. Her disguise was that of a Konoichi-turned-merchant employed by the Pekara Merchant House's outpost on the Fire Lightning border. But, in reality, she never retired from service. She also had a paltry 25 million ryo bounty placed on her head for her role in killing a band of bandits who tried to raid the Pekara Merchant caravan on the way to the Fire Capital. According to what Konoha knew about her, she had a bloodline called Fire Release, which allowed her to wield purple flames. She and her entourage of Pekara merchants would travel to Konoha twice a week. She was also so devoted to her emperor that she nearly blew her cover when she arrived on the anniversary of Naruto's exile. Fortunately, her co-workers had calmed her down. So imagine her surprise when, as she was packing up the stand and preparing to return to the Fire Capital, she was summoned to the Hokage Tower by three ANBU members to face the Konoha Council. Jiraiya was also present and stood on the sidelines. The Sannin had not fared well over the years. His reputation had suffered as a result of his involvement in Naruto's betrayal. The Ika Ika movie would not be made because Daimyo Kazahana's Ika Ika series had stopped selling throughout the elemental countries. Jiraiya had narrowly escaped his last mission. Jiraiya was ambushed near Angakure by Konan and the Six Paths of Pain while investigating the Akatsuki. Jiraiya had nearly died in the encounter despite his senjutsu and toad summon. Last, his Ika Ika series had lost popularity as a result of Murasaki Shibaku's Picara Merchant series of romantic novels and poems emerging from the West. Murasaki's novels, much to Jiraiya's chagrin, were far superior to the raunchy Ika Ika series. So much so that Koyuki Kazahana agreed to star in the films. Tsunade took a look at the former Konoichi, who was easily identified by her crimson flak vest and ninjato strapped to her back. Sachiko returned her gaze with a bored but curious expression. Kakashi Hatake and Sasuke Uchiha were also present, with the latter staring at her like she was a piece of meat. The slug sage swallowed and cleared her throat. "First and foremost, thank you for attending this meeting. You are not in any way in trouble. We simply have some questions for you." Sachiko sighed and shrugged her shoulders. "Shoot. First and foremost, what is your name?" Tsunade inquired. "I'm Sachiko Asahina, a merchant with the Picara Merchant House and a former captain of the Imperial Defense Forces, 3rd Battalion, 7th Division, 1st Squad." "You're a merchant, but you're armed and wearing a ninja flak vest," Koharu pointed out. "I wear it as a badge of honor, to remind myself that even though I'm a merchant, I'll always be a ninja," Sachiko explained. "The katana is only used for self-defense. Danzu and the other shinobi could respect that." An ANBU handed her a picture of Naruto in his man in black outfit, and Hinata in her Chunsam dress with a rose in her hair, but her face was turned away from the picture, making identification impossible. Tsunade inquired, "Can you identify the couple in the picture?" Sachiko replied, "Of course. That's the Emperor of the West, and the lady is his Empress Consort." The council chambers were filled with whispers and murmurs. Danzu inquired, "Do they have names?" "They do, but I am under orders not to say it. To that end, there is a seal on my tongue that prevents me from saying their names. The Emperor and his wife have many enemies, and there are those in the East who wish to make a name for themselves by assassinating his Imperial Majesty and assuming his throne. His clan is virtually the richest of all of the clans in the West." That made sense to the assembled shinobi. "That's not good enough," Asana Haruno exclaimed angrily. "Please tell us their names." Sachiko turned to face the member of the civilian council. "You don't like it? Tough shit, I report to the Emperor and Empress Consort, not you." "How dare you?" Asana exclaimed, leaping to her feet. "You will tell us their names right now, or we will arrest you," Tsunade said. "Haruno ... sit down. Leave it to the fiery Haruno to annoy their visitor." "But," Asana mumbled. "Shut up and sit down," yelled Gaudame, and Asana collapsed into her seat by sheer force of will. Tsunade returned to Sachiko after properly humiliating Asana. "I sincerely apologize for Representative Haruno's actions." "I accept your apology, Lady Hokage," Sachiko replied. "Do you want to learn more about the boss?" "The boss?" Tsunade asked again. "It's the Emperor's nickname," Sachiko explained. "It dates back to the time of the Unification War." "Yes, to answer your question," Tsunade said. "We'd like to learn more." "He's tall, 6 feet even, reddish blonde hair, blue eyes that turn purple with a ripple-like pattern when he uses his bloodline. Likes to wear black, earning him the nickname the Man in Black. I fought alongside him and his wife in the Unification War back when he was a teenager." "Soon began, you mean?" Sachiko gave a nod. "He unified the lands and became emperor when he was 16 years old, 2 years ago, an incredible feat for a child. He and the lady married during the final battle at South Ikiyama." Sasuke laughed. "As an elite, if I had been in command of the Imperial forces, I would have ended the conflict much sooner." With an innocent smile, Sachiko turned to face Uchiha. "I seriously doubt it. Word has it that you and two other Jounin-level shinobi were defeated by the boss, after he had killed a group of S-class shinobi. So much for being an elite. Can you tell us anything about his wife?" Shibaya Buram asked, quickly defusing the situation while Kakashi ordered Sasuke to sit. "His wife is no slouch. She is an expert in taijutsu and medical ninjutsu, and she founded the Imperial Medical Corps, which produces top-tier medics for both shinobi and samurai." Meanwhile, something clicked in Jiraiya's head. Sachiko had stated that his eyes were purple ... with ripples, indicating his ancestry. In their reports, Kakashi and Yamato both stated the same thing. "Your emperor ... the bloodline you described. Purple eyes with ripples," he asked. "Yes," Sachiko replied. The emperor wields the most powerful of the Dejutsu, the Rinnegan, which was passed down to him as a direct descendant of the Six Paths Sage, earning him the moniker Emperor of the Six Paths. I thought the Senju and Uchiha were the only ones descended from the Six Paths, Danzu explained. The Six Paths adopted the ancestors who would become the founders of the Uchiha and Senju clans, Sachiko explained calmly. The Six Paths had one child, a daughter, to whom the Rinnegan was passed down. She is the true descendant of the Six Paths. Tsunade nodded, and Sachiko exited with a fire shunsen and a small bow. The Hokage's office. Tsunade returned to her office after dispersing the council. The two elder advisors, Councilman Shimura and Jureya, were also present. Shizune stood nearby, her arms around Tonton. Tsunade inquired of her former teammate, "What do you know about the Rinnegan?" "Asahina says it's the most powerful of the Dejutsu," Jureya explained. "It allows the wielder to master all five elements. Only one other person had it, but I lost contact with him early on. Can't it be more powerful than the Sharingan?" Hinura wondered. Jureya confirmed, "It is." Add in the fact that the Emperor is not much older than the Uchiha, and the West has lived and breathed warfare since the Six Paths era, and the Emperor is a powerful warrior, possibly more powerful than the first four Hokages combined. "There's no way a snot-nosed brat could be more powerful than the Uchiha," exclaimed Koharu. "However, this is something we cannot ignore," Danzu added. "With Konoha's reputation in the gutter, we are at our weakest since the Nine Tails attacked us. Suna stands poised to take our position as the strongest Shinobi village, and the village in Spring Country is a serious threat to our standing. With the other nations supporting the Kyuubi brat, our enemies can attack us without penalty." "I concur," Hinura said. "From what I've heard, the unified West has powerful warriors, both Shinobi and Samurai. If we can form an alliance with him, we can send advisors to the Western Empire to ensure that he has Konoha's best interests in mind." Jureya and Tsunade were not aware of the hidden statement. Hamura's best interests literally meant using the Empire's resources and manpower to rebuild Konoha's infrastructure. And if the Emperor was a weakling, they could turn him into a puppet ruler while they controlled everything from behind the scenes. Tsunade looked at Jureya. "Looks like you're going to the Western Empire, Jureya. Consider this an S-ranked mission of the utmost importance. But you're not going alone. I want you to take Captains Haddock and Sarutobi with you, as well as Jounin's Haruno, and Yuzuka, and Aburame's escort. Aside from yourself, Koharu and Hinura will accompany you. Find out what the Emperor's motives are, and see." "If they are," Jureya inquired. "Because the Biju are the property of the Senju clan. The Jinchuriki are also the property of the Senju and the Leaf," Tsunade responded. "In order to keep the peace, my grandfather handed over the Biju to the other Shinobi villages. If the Emperor did indeed take the Jinchuriki, he shifted the balance of power in his favor. Which means that if he becomes hostile, he could unleash the Jinchuriki's power on the Leaf," Jureya concluded. "I'll accompany you," Danzu said. "Sasuke Uchiha and Sai will accompany me as my personal guards. Someone needs to determine whether the Empire will pose a threat to the Leaf in the future. If the Emperor decides to join our side, it will benefit us in the long run." Tsunade snapped, "Fine. Make sure you and Haddock keep the Uchiha under control. I will not have Konoha destroyed because that idiot can't keep his ego in check. Who knows? The Uchiha might find himself a wife in the Unified West, which could strengthen our claim even more." She looked around for a moment, then asked, "Where is Sasuke?" At the same time, Konoha's streets. Sachiko Asahina appeared ahead of the other Pekara merchants, who had just finished packing up their wares and loading them onto several horse-drawn carts. "Is everything all right, Captain?" Miko Nanakase inquired. She, unlike Sachiko, was a samurai tasked with protecting the Pekara merchants. Sachiko gave a nod. "Yes, everything is fine, let us proceed." As Sachiko and the Pekara caravan and their guard prepared to leave Konoha, they were met with an unwelcome sight. That sight belonged to Sasuke Uchiha. He wasn't alone, as two of Danzu's Rudanbu flanked him. Naruto had briefed the team of informants and merchants about the senior hierarchy within Konoha, as well as his former team, when she accepted the assignment to head overseas as part of the Empire's information network. So she was prepared when she was brought in for questioning by the Gaudam and the Council. "You're a strong Konoichi, Captain Asahina," Sasuke began, falling in step beside Sachiko, the Rudanbu close behind. "You have to be strong where I come from," Sachiko replied, "or you become the victim." "You know, I was there when your caravan was attacked by bandits," Sasuke continued, "and I take pride in seeing strength as well as beauty." Sachiko, on the other hand, was resisting the temptation to slaughter her emperor's former teammate. As you can see, I am an elite like you, Sasuke explained, though the people of Konohagakure treat me more like a prince. Can you do this quickly? Sachiko inquired, not to be rude, but my people and I have a long journey ahead of us. We must return to the outpost. Very well, Sasuke replied, Captain Asahina, I propose that we marry and unite our clans. Sachiko came to a halt and turned to face the Uchiha. I am honored that you would ask me to marry you, she said, but she had to decline because she was already married. That knocked Sasuke down. What does your husband possess that I lack? My name is Uchiha, an elite within an elite. It doesn't matter, Captain Asahina, I will be there when you need a true shinobi for a husband. I wouldn't hold my breath, you bastard, Sachiko mused as she and her caravan drove out of the village. Inside the House of Sovereigns the next day, Hayashi Hyuga, Hanabi Hyuga, Inoichi Yamanaka, Ino Yamanaka, Shikaku Nara, Shikamaru Nara, Chuza Akamichi, Chouji Akamichi, Anko Mitarashi, and Ibuki Morino stood before the Imperial Council, and Naruto and Hinata Namikaze sat at their usual heads at the table, along with Takuma Uzumaki, A, and Kurama. The news had been well received by the clan heads and their heirs, and the Empire was also home to half-demons and Hanyu, all of whom had sworn loyalty to the Emperor and Empress consort. Zabuza Mamichi was also present, the Mist Swordsman turned Demon Brigade General eager to meet the legendary Ibuki. As the council introduced themselves to the former clan heads and their children, Naruto and Hinata were all business, not letting their personal relationships with the Konoha refugees get in the way. Now, I've been going through your files with my wife and my advisors, and we've come up with your assignments, Naruto began. First and foremost, you are all promoted to Jounin in order to do your job. Hayashi, Hanabi, Ibuki, and both generations of the Ino Shikacho each retrieved a Hidai 8 from an aide who appeared before the refugees, holding several Hidai 8s on a small tray. Ibuki Morino ... Anko Mitarashi and Inoichi Yamanaka are assigned to the interrogation division, Naruto said after the aide had left. This is General Zabuza Mamichi, commander of the Demon Brigade and head of the interrogation division. You're the Demon of the Mist, Inoichi recognized. That I am, Zabuza responded, but I prefer the Demon of Kimin. The chief has spoken highly of you, Yamanaka, he said, turning to Ibuki, Morino. So we finally meet in the flesh. I've heard of you, Mamichi, Ibuki responded. I just wanted to say that I am a huge fan of your work, and I can't wait to see you in action, Zabuza said, explaining that here, we are in the business of interrogation and torture. And let me tell you, business is good here. You think Zabuza enjoys his job a little too much? Hinata nudged her husband. She said quietly, can't deny the results, Naruto replied, clearing his throat and continuing the meeting. Shikamaru Nara ... You noticed the Suna consulate in the city, right? Naruto asked. Yes, chief, the slacker replied. Your mission is to be my liaison to the Suna consulate, Naruto explained, and Temari is the Suna representative here. Shikamaru muttered under his breath, troublesome, but accepted the assignment. Shikaku Nara, as the Jounin commander, you are assigned to the Ministry of Shinobi Affairs under Akajima, Naruto explained. Despite your bad habits of being a slacker, you are also impartial and will not take sides when it comes to investigating shinobi matters. You will be accompanied by Chuza and his son. This does not imply that I will disassemble the Ino Shikacho. Both teams will be asked to assist the people. Ino Yamanaka ... Your file said you were studying to be a medic nin, right? Hinata asked. Yes, Lady Hinata, replied Ino. The Imperial Medic Corps has produced top-tier medic nins and combat medics, Hinata said, adding that Matsuri of Suna was a protege of mine, and she is now the head of Suna's medic program. You are welcome to study with me if you wish. I'd be honored, Lady Hinata, Ino said as she nodded her head. Since it's only fair for one of my husband's clansmen to serve as an advisor, I talked it over with the others, and they agreed to offer you the chance to join the advisor staff, Hinata said to her father. I accept your offer, Hayashi replied, but there is the issue of your position within the clan. Hanabi can take over as clan leader, Hinata suggested, and I will officially delegate that responsibility to her. And the other Hyuga? Hayashi asked, nodding. They'll be part of the military police force patrolling Kimin, Naruto responded. But there's something else I'd like to know. What were your thoughts on the other Jounin senseis? Sarutobi and his wife, Mado Gai, and Hadake all supported the Godaime and the CRA, Shikaku explained. At that moment, a shinobi from the intelligence division appeared via Shunshin and handed Naruto a scroll. Naruto thanked the shinobi, who then vanished and opened the scroll. Hinata frowned as he read the scroll's contents. Well, that didn't take them long, Naruto sighed. What exactly is it? Inoichi inquired. Naruto handed the scroll to a guard, who then handed it to Hayashi, allowing him and the other clan heads to read over his shoulder. Hayashi inquired. "I'm afraid so," Naruto responded. "But it was something I expected once the West became known to the countries and Shinobi villages back east. It appears that I will have to confront my past." "Troublesome," Shikaku said, adding, "Senju has sent Jiraiya, Shimura, Mitakato, and Yudatain here, along with Hadake, Sarutobi, and the remnants of Cells 7 and 8. Konoha has become desperate," Naruto explained, "and with my exile, they had become a virtual pariah state, along with the rest of Fire Country. With four of their clans present, as well as some of their most experienced Jounin, Konoha will no longer be regarded as one of the strongest by the other major villages. Suna will most likely replace Konoha as the strongest village." "There's still the envoy," Sanchi said, interlacing his fingers. "With Konoha's reputation gone, Senju had more than likely sent the envoy here to negotiate a military and political alliance." "Second," Katsumoto continued, "because the imperial nation, like our rulers, is still young, Konoha would only leech off of us, using our resources to further their agenda. Most of the time, they would turn our emperor into a puppet ruler." "How about Danzu?" Shikaku inquired. "It takes a warhawk to know a warhawk," said the elder samurai, adding, "Shimura wants to investigate our military capabilities to gauge our strength. We have the muscle, despite their political savvy, but most importantly, to determine whether we pose a threat. If he sees us as such, he will almost certainly, shall we say, cut the head off the snake." "Are you certain about that?" Hayashi inquired. "If I were Shimura, I would," Sanchi replied. "What is the exact arrival time?" "They'll arrive Thursday night," Naruto said, "and as much as I'd like to turn them away, I can't because it would violate the laws of hospitality in regards to foreign envoys. In the meantime, with Cell 9, Tenten, Rock Lee, and Neji, Hyuga decided to walk around the Imperial Capital while Naruto and the Imperial Council planned how they would deal with Jiraiya and the Konoha envoy once they arrived. Neji was in good spirits following the removal of the caged bird seal, and he could publicly pursue his relationship with Tenten without any consequences. As noon approached, the trio was strolling through the Imperial Capital's merchant district when Tenten had been their teammate for many years, and she took pride in being the resident weaponsmaster for Selgai. So when Neji and Rock Lee stopped and looked at what had caused Tenten to stop, they shook their heads in resignation. Which is why Tenten paused at Kimmon's premier weapons shop. The sign on the side read Himura Weapons and Accessories. Neji and Rock Lee followed Tenten inside. Weapons lined the walls. Swords, staffs, various melee weapons, the works. The weapons vendor was easily identified by her khaki flak vest as a Hellcats member, and she looked older than. "Do you need assistance with anything?" the vendor inquired. "No," Tenten said, shaking her head. "I'm just looking." "I see you have an eye for weapons," the vendor commented. "You have no idea," Neji said, ignoring his girlfriend's sour expression. "You won't find any better weapons here in the West, or in the East, for that matter," the vendor said, drawing the attention of the trio. "How did you do it?" Rock Lee started. "It's a very hot topic among the people here. That, and the fact that you three are clearly not from here. Where have my manners gone? My name is Miko Himura. This is my family's arsenal. I used to own a weapons shop back in Konoha," Tenten explained, "but I had to sell it when I left Konoha during the Exodus." Tenten picked up a knife and examined it, noting that the blade was about 24 inches long, with an inwardly curved cutting edge. "That's a popular weapon in the Laja Mountains north of here," Miko said, "and the Empress has a pair. It's known as a Kukri knife." "It's lovely," Tenten said. "The metal used in our weapons comes from the Laja Mountains," Miko explained, "where the iron is very strong. We do custom orders in addition to selling weapons, as our clan is also the best swordsmiths and metalworkers in the West. We have katanas, ninjatos, tantos, Dao broadswords, and pretty much anything else your heart desires. We also sell extras like storage scrolls, weights, and even medical kits." "So, who are you, samurai or shinobi?" Neji inquired. Miko responded, "Samurai, recently promoted to the rank of Saizebushi, which is the samurai equivalent of Jounin." "So you're from Konoha, so you knew the chief and his wife when they were kids, right?" When the trio nodded, Miko inquired, "So, how were they?" "He wore orange," Tenten deadpanned, "a color that screamed kill me. That, and he was known as the Konoha's unpredictable, knucklehead ninja. His wife is a cousin of mine. When we were in the academy, she had a crush on him. For lack of a better word, our relationship was strained," Neji said, recalling the Chunin exams, when he nearly killed Hinata out of spite, followed by Naruto beating him inside the Konoha Stadium. Fortunately, she's not the type to hold grudges. I've seen that same type of vest on several of the Kunoichi and Samurai, Tenten said of the flak vest. This identifies me as a Hellcats member, Miko said, noticing Yujito enter the store while the other three shinobi did not. Who are the Hellcats? What's that? Tenten repeated. The Hellcat unit is an all-female unit under my command, consisting of Kunoichi and Anna Bujeisha. Yujito explained, relishing the fact that she had gotten the jump on the three former Konoha shinobi. We are the best at what we do, and I won't work with anyone who isn't up to snuff. Do you have a weapons expert? Tenten inquired. Yeah, but she is my samurai weapons specialist, Yujito replied, pointing to Miko. Why? Do you want to sign up? Tenten nodded. I'm interested in learning more. You show promise, and I pride myself on discovering such talent, Yujito said to the younger woman. Come back later for lunch at the Red Lotus. We'll talk more later. Tenten nodded eagerly, all right. The Konoha envoy, comprised of Jiraiya, the two elders, Asuma Sarutobi, Kakashi Hatake, Sai, and the remnants of Cells 7 and 9, arrived in Kimin City late Thursday night, as Tsunade and the Konoha Council had made it clear. The Konoha envoy was to gain an audience with the Emperor of the Unified West and seek a military and political alliance with Konoha and Fire Country. The first thing Jiraiya and the others did upon arrival in the Imperial Capital was secure lodgings for their stay. The customs officer who had checked their identification had directed them to the Red Lotus Inn, a three-story inn and restaurant catering to tourists and dignitaries. Jiraiya and the others were unaware that the owner of the Red Lotus was married to a member of the Empire's Information Division, which the members of the Demon Brigade W. The Konoha group had requested a guide to show them around the Imperial Capital once they had settled in. The Red Lotus was built around two hot springs, and the Red Lotus was famous for its springs. Only the hot springs in the Laja Mountains surpassed those found at the inn. Of course, it took both Asuma and Kakashi to keep Jiraiya from peeping in the hot springs. Meanwhile, inside the Sovereign's house, the Emperor and Empress of the Unified Western Empire were meeting with the Captain of the Elite Guards, the team of shinobi and samurai assigned to protect the Emperor and Empress consort. The Nisato Minazuki was a member of the Minazuki clan, which was known as the Snake Tribe to both shinobi and samurai for good reason, as the Minazuki clan were poison specialists and claimed ancestry from. Aside from being poison specialists, the Minazuki were also skilled assassins, and were a major thorn in Rokubungi Oda's side when he ran Kimin. Like Orochimaru, the Minazuki had snake summons, but unlike Manda, theirs had multiple heads and was much larger, with Binisato's main summon being the seven-headed serpent known as Ajaha. Their taijutsu style was also modeled around them. Binisato was as tough as she was beautiful, and she was dressed in her casual attire, which reminded Naruto of Tsunade's attire, save for the colors. The white haori with the design of Yamada no Orochi on the back, a black sleeveless kimono-style blouse held closed by a gray obi, and her pants are the same color as her blouse and obi. Binisato, as Naruto and Hinata discovered, was the polar opposite of Orochimaru. She had the beauty and brains to match the snake Sannin, but not his ego or desire for immortality. Despite being roughly the age of the Sannin, she looked like she was in her mid-20s. She did not use an immortality jutsu like Orochimaru or a genjutsu like Tsunade, but her mother, Seiko Minazuki, was the clan's matriarch. She was offered a seat on the council, but declined, deciding to retire from the position and naming her second child, Binisato's younger brother Benjiru, as her successor. Benjiru worked in the Shinobi Affairs Division. A prodigy in her younger days, she was the only one who could beat Takuma Chiba 6 falls out of 10, and could give the Empress consort. Binisato also had run-ins with the shinobi from Konohagakure no Sato while accompanying her Emperor and Empress to the east on inspections of consulates and Picara merchant houses. While competing in a taijutsu tournament in Tea Country, she defeated Mado Gai, who was there with several other jounin investigating the Emperor and Empress consort, unknowns to both of them at the time. Did you want to see me? She inquired. Think of this as an S-class assignment, Binisato, Naruto said, nodding. Nothing difficult or fancy. I'd like you to accompany the Konoha envoy when they arrive. Why me? Mused the Snake Queen. Hinata and I want to keep an eye on Jiraiya and the others, Naruto explained. And I wouldn't be surprised if Jiraiya and the others do something strange while they're here. They would be less likely to attack you now that you have faced and defeated the majority of them in combat. That, and Jiraiya despises snakes because they remind him of his former teammate, Hinata added. Okay, Chief, Lady Hinata, Binisato said after a brief moment of thought. I'll accept the task. What happened to them? They're at the Red Lotus Inn, Hinata replied, and please don't kill them. Okay, I'll take my leave, Binasato said as she walked out of the council chambers on her heel. Minutes later, Red Lotus in. The next day, the Konoha Shinobi were informed that their guide had arrived, much to Jiraiya's surprise and horror. Their tour guide was the snake lady he had met back in Tea Country, now fully clothed, with a somewhat amused expression at seeing Jiraiya's reaction upon seeing her again. You're the one. Jiraiya exclaimed, pointing to the woman. Asuma Sarutobi and Kakashi Hatake both recognized the woman. Are you the group looking for a tour of the city? You're looking at her, Binasato said, introducing herself as Major Binasato Minazuki, commander of the elite guard. She turned to Jiraiya, so you're leading this group, you old pervert. Kiba gave Binasato a strange look and confirmed, you smell a lot like snakes. Do you have a problem with that, dog breath? Binasato asked the feral Jounin, watching as her serpent tattoo began to shift slightly. She inquired sweetly. No, Kiba said quickly, shaking his head. Not at all. Are you familiar with Jiraiya? Asuma inquired, shifting the subject. Of course, Binasato replied. The pervert tried to peek in on me one night a while back while I was enjoying a late night soak in the hot springs back in Tea Country. Several months ago, in Tea Country, Jiraiya had no trouble sneaking into the women's hot springs, but he was disappointed when he arrived because there was only one woman inside. Jiraiya could only see her backside, but he could tell she was very curvaceous, her skin an exotic shade of pale, and she had long dark hair, but it was slung over one shoulder. Jiraiya also noticed that her backside and shoulders were covered in tattoos, blue clouds and lotus blossoms ... and, much to Jiraiya's chagrin, snakes. Why did it have to be snakes? Jiraiya wondered. Are you lost? The woman had sensed Jiraiya's presence. Is this the women's bath? She inquired. Jiraiya quickly recovered from his gaffe, saying, sorry, I seem to have lost my way, and... Jiraiya paused in mid-speech as she examined the woman's body art. Was his mind playing tricks on him, or were the snake tattoos on her back moving? No, he wasn't insane, the snake tattoos were moving. Jiraiya would have jumped on the woman if it hadn't been for the fact that his life was in danger from the snake tattoos, which had now removed themselves from her body, and taken on a more lifelike form. But Jiraiya didn't. A smile spread across his face as he recognized her from a few weeks earlier, when she defeated both Orochimaru and his lackey near the Windfire border. It's not very nice to try and peep in on women, you know, she said, outstretched her hand, her snakes coiled, ready to strike, fangs dripping with venom, and my snake's venom is so potent that it can make your little boys impotent. Jiraiya reacted appropriately to the threat of being rendered infertile, turning and fleeing for his life. Once the perverted Sannin was gone, the snakes reverted to their tattoo-like forms and re-encrusted themselves on the woman's body, and she began to laugh herself silly, relishing the fact that she had scared the crap out of her emperor's former godson. Sekura and Koharu gave Jiraiya a death glare, while Asuma and Kakashi shook their heads. After the Konohagakure envoy introduced themselves, Danzu looked at the woman with interest, saying, "That is a very interesting technique you have." As it should, Binasato replied, raising her left hand and allowing the snake tattoo on her arm and forearm to come to life. The dark snake coiled around her arm, flicking its forked tongue out and hissing at Jiraiya. The Minazuki and the snake are inextricably linked. The snake returned to its normal position and transformed back into a tattoo. How about the city tour? Asuma inquired. Of course, Binasato replied, we'll start there because we're closest to the hospital. The Empress will not be present because she will be in a series of meetings with the council with her husband. Major Yamada, the lady's second-in-command, and Director Yuzumaki will, however, be present. Binasato took note of the Konoha envoy's reactions when she said Yuzumaki. Jiraiya's mood darkened, as did Asuma and Kakashi. Sekura looked angry, as did Kiba. Sasuke looked smug. Sai looked ... well, like Sai. Danzu's frown deepened. Koharu and Hanmura kept their tongues in check, lest they say the wrong thing and get kicked out. Did you mention Yuzumaki? Sekura said again. Yes, Binasato confirmed, referring to Director Karin Yuzumaki. She was an Empress Consort's understudy, along with Matsuri of Suna. Jiraiya and the others were stunned. Oh, you say Yuzumaki. I thought the Yuzumaki clan was wiped out in the last war back in the east, Danzu said again. Oh, no, Binasato replied. The Yuzumaki is one of the West's great imperial clans. Takuma Yuzumaki is the clan patriarch. Takuma Yuzumaki was the younger brother of Kushina Yuzumaki, making her Minato's brother-in-law ... and, more importantly, Naruto's uncle. He was known as the Maelstrom of Whirlpool for his skills in Fuinjutsu and Ninjutsu ... as well as his fierce temper. The wheels in Jiraiya's head were turning as Binasato led him and the others to the hospital. Kushina had told him once she was safe in Konoha that the Uzumaki had been decimated, that only a few remained after Yuzushi-Agakura's destruction. But Kushina had been more cunning than Jiraiya had given her credit for. So, Kushina, you must have known Whirlpool was going to fall, and obviously you did not trust Konoha, but you were married to Minato, so your hands were tied, so you had Takuma and the surviving Uzumaki and Whirlpool Shinobi flee the country. Never would have suspected that they would relocate here. Well played, Kushina. Well played indeed. What Jiraiya didn't realize was that the bodies of the Yuzushi-Agakure Shinobi that littered the ruined village were actually those of Kumo and Iwa Shinobi dressed in Uzu's uniforms. Kushina had ordered her brother, the Yondame Uzukage, to relocate the entire village to its fallback location, which was located in the west. Out of sight, out of mind. But a second thought entered Jiraiya's mind. If Naruto fled to the west and discovered he had family here and if they discovered Konoha's betrayal from him. As Binisato led him and the others to the hospital, he pushed that thought from his mind. The Imperial Hospital of Kimin was larger than the one in Konoha, and it was divided into two buildings, the main hospital, which was a five-story structure, and the smaller, three-story structure, which housed the hospital's intensive care unit for its more serious cases. Karin Uzumaki, the hospital's director, and Kokoro Yamada, the Empress Consort's number two in the medic program, had given the Konoha envoy a tour of the hospital. Aside from medic ninjas who worked with the shinobi, the samurai had combat medics. The medics in training received basic medic training from the academy, which included human anatomy, chakra control, and studying medical texts. The medic nins, as Sakura and the others observed, were skilled in techniques such as the chakra scalpel and the mystic palm jutsu, but they were also skilled in acupuncture and shiatsu, finger and palm pressure, stretches, and other massaging techniques, whereas the combat medics, who did not use chakra, relied on the latter. What surprised Sakura and the others was that someone of them had incorporated their various elemental releases into the medical. When Sakura questioned the effectiveness of the Imperial combat medics, Karin and Kuda took them to an observation room to watch an operation in progress. The patient was a prominent merchant working for the Picara Merchant House, who was being operated on for a ruptured appendix, while Karin explained the procedure. First, they used shiatsu to dull the pain from his appendix, then they used it to knock him out cold. Despite the fact that the Imperial Medic Corps was far more advanced than Konoha's own program, Sakura Haruno, Danzu, and the two elders were all impressed. After Binisato had returned her charges, Danzu suggested that they go check out the school for shinobi and samurai in training. In the Unified West, the training school for the rising shinobi and samurai had no official name. It was simply known as the Academy. The largest ones were in the major cities in the west, Kimin, Kurata Port, Shinzoku, South Ikeyama, and Tears Point. Located in the western part of Kimin, the academy was easily twice the size of the Shinobi Academy in Konoha, a compound onto itself, complete with dorms for orphan children who were being trained as samurai and shinobi. When Naruto and Hinata became emperor and empress consort, they realized that a national system of education for the next generation of samurai and shinobi was required. The second thing Naruto and Hinata did after establishing the elite guard was to organize a system of shinobi and samurai training schools. Unlike the Shinobi Academy in Konoha, which by their time had been watered down, and in most cases, the academy had two headmasters, one samurai and one shinobi. The shinobi headmistress was Azumi Kato, a Jounin-level shinobi, and the samurai headmaster was Ryuhaku Kajima, a Saizebushi who had been informed of the visit and was asked to give Naruto and Hinata a tour of the facility. As the students entered their final 2 years at the academy, they began to take specialized classes in their fields. Those who showed an interest in pursuing a medical career would begin taking classes in basic and advanced medicine. Upon graduation, aside from being assigned to their cells, the rising medic nins and combat medics would spend 2 days out of the week at the hospital. The training is brutal, yes, but it makes them tough, said Headmaster Kajima and Headmistress Kato. And the homework, simply put, an S-rank mission to Konoha is equivalent to a C-rank mission to Imperial Shinobi and Samurai. Jiraiya and Danzu wanted to see more, but Binisato refused, citing national security concerns. In short, the Academy's training methods were far superior to Konoha's own, as much as the elders and Jiraiya hated to admit, as the Empire's methods cranked out battle-worthy. So the young shinobi and samurai in training go to the same classes, Koharu inquired as they exited the Academy. Yes, Binisato replied. as the Imperial Defense Forces are both shinobi and samurai. They train together and fight together. The Emperor and Empress believe that a warrior's strength, whether they are a shinobi or a samurai, comes from the warrior who is fighting by his side. Something that Sanji has taught them both. Show respect and honor to those who fight by your side, and it will be returned a hundredfold. Sanji. Danzu repeated the name, which he had heard before when he was younger. He is the Minister of Defense and the only samurai to ever achieve the rank of Kodenbushi, the legendary samurai, similar to Konoha's legendary Sannin. Benisato explained. Jiraiya knew this because he, Tsunade, and Orochimaru had faced the cunning samurai in a 3-on-1 battle and lost shortly after their encounter with Hanzu the Salamander. And Sanji had also defeated Hiruzen Sarutobi, known to Konoha as the Professor, and the God of Shinobi, and fought General Mifune to a draw. Samurai have a ranking system similar to Shinobi, the Snake Queen explained, and Anisebushi is the equivalent of Genin. Shukenbushi is the Chunin equivalent. And Jounin is the equivalent of Saizebushi. Only a Saizebushi or a cell of Anisebushi can accept apprentices. Sasuke decided to speak up at that point, saying, a shinobi will always be stronger than a samurai. Benisato came to a halt and turned around. Know this, she said curtly, I've fought with samurai. They are as hardy as battle-hardened Jounin. A samurai may be better suited for a mission than a shinobi in some cases, and vice versa. The emperor himself has been trained in both the shinobi and samurai traditions, as you can attest painfully. Benisato had him there. For all his talk about being an elite, the emperor was clearly stronger than him. Seeing that the Uchiha was properly humbled for the time being, Benisato resumed the tour. Since it's Friday, you're in for a treat, Benisato said. Even though we're at peace, the Emperor and Empress consort want our forces to be razor sharp. Every Friday, we hold local tournaments in Kimin and throughout the Empire. We're on our way to the Proving Grounds right now. Do you hold local tournaments? Kiba inquired, now perplexed. Yes, Benisato said, nodding. It provides free entertainment for civilians while also encouraging healthy rivalry between samurai and shinobi. The Imperial Kumite is also held in South Ikeyama every first week of July. In the Imperial Kumite, only the best of the best compete. Interesting, thought Sasuke as he and the others followed Benisato. The Proving Grounds were Kimin's response to Konoha's training grounds, where shinobi could hone their skills. The Proving Grounds, located on the outskirts of the Imperial Capital, was 3 times the size of Training Ground Number 44, the Forest of Death. The Proving Grounds were divided into 4 sections, Ground No. 1 was the Enlightenment Grounds, where samurai and shinobi meditated in peace with the assistance of shinobi monks who kept the grounds in order. The Weapons Grounds were Ground No. 2, where shinobi and samurai sparred with their various weapons. The Jutsu Grounds were where the shinobi practiced their techniques. Of course, Sasuke attempted to steal the jutsu using the Sharingan, but discovered that when he activated his dejutsu, it would automatically cut off. He tried again, but the same thing happened. Danzu, unknown to both the last Uchiha and Hadake, attempted the same thing with his own hidden Sharingan, but had the same results as the Uchiha and his former sensei. Last but not least was Ground Number 3, also known as the Arena. The Arena, located in the heart of the Proving Grounds, was a large open area devoid of trees. The arena was surrounded on 3 sides by a series of stands. On the left side, beside the stands, was a lodge that served as a medical station. It reminded the Konoha group of the Chunin Exam Stadium in some ways. In the center of the arena, a massive lettai, a circular training platform, was placed. The inscription around the lettai's edge read, "The brave do not fear the grave." Because the stands were already packed with spectators and competitors, Benisato and the Konoha group simply stood to the side and watched as the matches began. As the tournament progressed, Asuma and Kakashi realized that the Western Shinobi and Samurai were incredibly tough, even tougher than their Kumo and Iwa counterparts. Sasuke snorted, dismissing Western Shinobi and Samurai as weak and unworthy of the power they possessed. As they continued to watch the tournaments, Koharu and Henmura were literally drooling and salivating as the gears in their heads went into overdrive. The West had the muscle, but Konoha had the political advantage in their eyes. Danzu was planning something, despite his expression. Plans to use the Empire's Shinobi as new recruits for his Rude NBU. However, 2 of the combatants had attracted Jiraiya and the others' attention as soon as they stepped onto the lettai. Neji Hyuga and Rock Lee. Benisato stood there watching Taichi Chiba walk onto the lettai. Interesting. The two-on-one match, she thought. Jiraiya looked at Binisato. Huh? The Snake Queen motioned to Taishi, who had silently ordered both the Hyuga prodigy and the Gokin expert to back up, allowing him to stand between the two former Konoha shinobi. Taishi Chiba, she explained, the elite guard's resident taijutsu master. Very dangerous. Very tough, but not as tough as me. So are those two, Jiraiya said as the fight began. I'm sure you're aware that they were previously Konoha shinobi. Word spreads, Binisato said, noticing Sanchi, Hayashi Hyuga, Kuda Chiba, and Takuma Yuzumaki seated together and talking. In fact, it's the talk of the empire. The emperor has granted political asylum to the four clan heads and the jounin who accompanied them. Do you have any idea why the emperor would do such a thing? Sekura inquired, granting them asylum and risking the leaf's wrath. Jiraiya gave Sekura a look that told her to stop talking. He then noticed Hayashi and the other council members watching the fight. It has been confirmed that Hayashi and the others were granted asylum by the Emperor and Empress consort. So, if they're here, could he be too? He thought as he watched the fight between the two former Konoha shinobi and Taishi Chiba. Despite the efforts of Neji and Rock Lee, they were no match for Taishi, who defeated both of them. Jiraiya's room at the Red Lotus Inn. Binisato had returned the Konoha group to the Red Lotus after the tournament, and had left for her own home. Jiraiya had summoned everyone to his room for a quick meeting about what they had witnessed that day. Jiraiya, on the other hand, was disappointed that he couldn't meet Murasaki Shibuku. I can honestly say that the Western Shinobi and Samurai have impressed me, Asuma said, recalling the match between Guy's former students and Taishi Chiba, Binisato's teammate. The taijutsu expert ... He held his own against Neji and Rock Lee. That guy belonged with the Fire Lord's Guardian Ninja. Their shinobi and samurai training methods are very impressive, Shino said. The most logical conclusion is that they combine classroom instruction and field training to produce battle-worthy shinobi. The Imperial Medic Corps methods for training their medic nins. Sekura began as she compiled a series of reports for Tsunade once she returned to Konoha. Lady Tsunade may be one of the best medic nins in Elemental Nation's history, but even she couldn't come up with what I've seen. Whoever the Empress is ... As much as I hate to say it, she could surpass Tsunade in medical knowledge. Koharu and Hinmira were exchanging notes while Danzu remained silent. Danzu was concerned. The Uzumaki clan was still alive and well. Takuma Uzumaki remained alive. His train of thought was interrupted when he heard Sasuke express his displeasure to his former sensei and everyone in the room. I'm not impressed, headache. These Westerners are beneath the leaf, beneath me, an elite, and if given the opportunity, I would show them all the might of the Uchiha. Remember what I taught you in Sakura, Sasuke, Kakashi replied. You must look beneath the hidden meanings. You may be good, having trained with myself and Danzu, but not even you could face down one of the Empire's warriors. We both fought the Emperor and lost. The Emperor got lucky, Sasuke replied. Without that title, he is nothing in comparison to me. Asuma was growing tired of Sasuke's nonsense. Sasuke, stop talking. Sasuke's attention was drawn to the Sarutobi clan's leader. Sarutobi, what did you say? I told you to shut up. Asuma yelled, leaping to his feet and reaching for his trench knives. You couldn't let go of the fact that the Emperor had beaten you in combat. You couldn't accept the fact that there is someone out there who is stronger than you. Sasuke rose to his feet, his eyes transforming into the Majin Kaiowu. Do you know who you're talking to? He snarled, reaching for his Chokudo. Someone who has only caused trouble for Konoha, Asuma retorted. At least the demon brat of a teammate was more loyal than you ever were. Even if they won't tell you because they worship the ground you walk on. But I will. All of this is not Uzumaki's fault, but yours. You tried to run to Orochimaru, but the Kyuubi brat stopped you, despite the fact that you shoved a Chidori into his chest. It was because of him that we had trade and military alliances and it. The only reason Dobe won was because he had the power of the Nine Tails behind him. Sarutobi, Sasuke reminded him. That's the kettle calling the kettle black. Because you had the power of Orochimaru's cursed seal. And that wasn't even enough for you to kill him. Not to mention that my father, the Sannin, and the council had purposely stunted his growth. So who is stronger? The dead last, or the elite? Asuma said as he exited the room. We should have kept the Kyuubi brat and banished you instead. He raged, slamming the door shut behind him. As the Majin Kaiowu began to spin, Sasuke became enraged. That tiny, Sasuke, please stand down, Danzu said. Sarutobi has a point about the Emperor. The Rinnegan is indeed stronger than the Sharingan. And the fact that the Emperor did not use it in the fight shows that he is a powerful shinobi. Jiraiya rose to his feet. I'll calm Asuma down while everyone else goes to bed. We have a big day tomorrow. Jiraiya and the Konoha group were having breakfast at the Red Lotus restaurant the next morning. Because it was a Saturday morning, the dining area was mostly empty. The tension between Sasuke Uchiha and Asuma Sarutobi from the previous night was still palpable, which is why both men sat on opposite sides of the table. Sasuke had forgotten how Asuma had told him that his dead last of a former teammate was more valuable than him, and vowed to repay the Sarutobi clan head for that insult. It's a shame his little bastard of a nephew in his cell died, Sasuke reflected darkly. I would have loved to have used Genjutsu on them. The previous night, Sasuke dismissed the Imperial forces as inept and unworthy of his presence. But it was Koharu and Hanmura who had swayed Sasuke's opinion. They stroked his ego, as they had done since he was a child, telling him that through this alliance, he would learn the Empire's secrets, and that through the Empire, he would become even more powerful. Powerful enough to kill Itachi and once and for all prove to his missing teammate that he was indeed the strongest. That appealed to Sasuke. He would not only beat Naruto's head into powder after killing Itachi, but he would also crush the Emperor under his might. The restaurant was then entered by four people. The locals who were present were aware of who they were and were wise enough to stay out of their way. These four highly trained shinobi and samurai were part of the Empire's elite special forces unit. A quartet of S-ranked warriors whose bloodlines granted them the ability to wield the power of the elements of wind, earth, fire, and lightning. This was the same group of fighters who had easily defeated the Akatsuki. Only the Emperor and Empress were more powerful and skilled than them. They went by several names. Shaitano is a Shaitano. The four divine kings, the four goddesses. They moved over to Jiraiya's and the others' table. Kiba was the first to notice them and alerted Jiraiya and the others to their presence. The first member was a carbon copy of Picara Merchant and Imperial spy Sachiko Asahina. In reality, she was her identical twin sister, the eldest by 5 minutes, except that Sachiko had long hair, and she had short hair. She wielded the power of the flames, just like her twin sister, but hers were black, whereas Sachiko's were red. She was dressed in the Imperial Defense Forces standard Jounin uniform, a black Shazoku uniform over a red Jounin flak vest. Her back was strapped with a ninjutsu, her hidaiate cinched around her neck. Sadako Asahina, the mistress of the dark flames, was her name. The second member was a female as well. She was the product of a union between a Kanoichi and a Ronin samurai, which meant she was trained in both the ways of the shinobi and samurai, making her part of the samurai ninja warrior class who embraced both styles. She was a Shinoku native who belonged to an ancient warrior cult that worshipped the deity Asura. She didn't wear a flak vest with her outfit, which included a black bustier, black pants, and boots. Her boots were stuffed with two tantos. Her dark hair cascaded behind her back. Her left leg was wrapped around her forehead protector. She appeared exotic, her clear gray eyes disdainfully looking down on the Konoha group. Heed Kiriyama was the Divine Wind's protector. The third member was a bald and beardless mountain of a man who stood 7 feet tall, and was literally a walking mountain of muscle. His armor resembled hand steam armor in appearance, with the exception that there was no steam. Aside from the armor, he was dressed in black pants and barefoot. He was the group's oldest member, tanned, and enjoyed a good fight. A massive broadsword the size of Zabuza's head-chopping cleaver was strapped to his back. He, too, wrapped his hidaiate around his bicep. Kintaro Kagami was the Scorched Earth Strongman. The group's final member was the leader. Jiraiya and the others mistook him for Naruto for a split second because of his blonde hair and blue eyes. But this guy was far from it. He was dressed in armor that resembled Dodo Kazahana's prototype chakra armor, but it was red with golden trim rather than Dodo's black with blue trim. It wasn't chakra armor, but rather his clan's armor. He was dressed in a black haori over his armor. The outfit was completed with black pants and sandals. His hidaiate was embroidered on his haori. Rasu was the Violent Lightning's shogun. "You guys stand out like a sore thumb," Rasu began. "Then again, I'm not surprised. Eastern shinobi with a death wish. Hello, tourists." Danzu smirked. "We're not tourists," he corrected. Rasu responded, "Oh, come on. Here you are, in our home, taking in the sights, seeing what the Western Empire has to offer, and let's face it, you're tourists." Sasuke stood up and activated his Sharingan. "Now take a look here, you." Rasu raised one hand, index and middle finger extended, and he backed away. "Ah," Rasu said as golden lightning flashed across his finger. "You really should control your temper, Uchiha, or I'll have to explain to my boss why I had to fry your ass." "Don't, Sasuke," Jiraiya warned. "I have heard of these four, they're the four Devas," he said to Rasu. "This is the one who defeated Itachi and his companion." Rasu confirmed. "The old man speaks the truth." We went on an inspection tour to the east with the chief and his wife, and the emperor gave us his blessing to test our skills against the Akatsuki as long as we didn't kill any of them. He looked at Sasuke. So you're Itachi's younger brother. I've seen worse, but I've also seen worse. How dare you speak to me like that, commoner? Snarled Sasuke. Keep running your mouth, runt, Rasu threatened, and I'll do to you what I did to your brother. Rasu dispersed the lightning when he heard Sadako clear her throat. Oh, right. You're to come with us. The Emperor and Empress consort would like to speak with you, and we're just here to make sure everything stays nice and civil. Sadako cautioned Kiba, and keep your dog under control. Otherwise, I'll have to put him down. Council chambers in the Hall of Sovereigns. Naruto sat in his chair, dressed in all black, the cage-style hat over his head, eyes closed to conceal his now active Rinnegan, trying to calm the emotions that were coursing through his mind. Naruto had the right to refuse any envoy who came before him as emperor, but he decided to see how far Konoha had progressed during his absence. Hinata and Kurama were also present. Hayashi was not present. Hinata's bangs had effectively hidden her eyes from view. The entire council was also present. That, and whether he could keep his cool and not kill his former teammates, sensei, and godfather for betraying him the moment they entered the room. Naruto was not going to take any chances, especially against the Sharingan. He was aware that the Rinnegan possessed the ability to repel the Sharingan's genjutsu, but his council did not. That's why, for the past hour, he'd been placing special anti-genjutsu seals on the council, and activating them minutes before the Konoha group arrived. The door opened, and Naruto opened his eyes just as the four Devas, Jiraiya, Asuma Sarutobi, the three elders, and the remnants of cells 7 and 8 entered the council chambers. The four Devas stepped aside, allowing the Konoha group to confront the emperor and empress consort. Jiraiya and the three elders were surprised to see a seated on the council as one of the emperor's advisors, because they had heard that his brother and several of their supporters had been killed when he was deposed. Jiraiya appeared to Naruto to be the same, a backstabbing, super pervert. Kakashi was all business because the little orange book he usually read was nowhere to be found. Sakura wore a jounin vest and was dressed as a medic nin. Sasuke, on the other hand, was sizing him up, sharing an active and arrogant as ever. Danzu was acting similarly. Koharu and Hanira watched with bated breath, as if hoping Naruto would agree to their terms for an alliance. Akamaru growled at Baijamaru, who growled back until Kiba shushed him. Looking at Hinata, he couldn't shake the feeling that the Empress was someone he knew well. That, and the red-headed woman seated next to the former Raikage smelled strongly of foxes for some strange reason. Naruto concentrated on Danzu. Aside from Koharu and Hanira, the Warhawk had been by his side since his genin days. A hidden Sharingan behind those bandages and he's trying to sway the council. Thank goodness those anti-genjutsu seals I designed are effective. They were indeed working. Otherwise, Naruto would have detected the Sharingan's influence on the council members. What is it? Naruto reflected as he continued to stare at Danzu. The Warhawk is not as crippled as he appears. A false arm beneath his robes with multiple Sharingans grafted, combined with the Senju clan's Mokouten. I'm curious how the old hag and that idiot former teammate of mine would react if I told them that the Warhawk stole their clan's bloodlines. Jiraiya, Koharu, Hanira, and Danzu bowed together, with the other Konoha shinobi following suit. Except for Sasuke, who smirked at the Imperial Council for his obvious disrespect. Until Kakashi looked up, grabbed his former student by the back of the neck, and forced him to bow as well. Jiraiya began to speak, assuming the role of de facto negotiator. Lord Emperor, I wish you a long and prosperous reign, and I am. Jiraiya of the legendary Sannin, Naruto began, masking his voice with chakra as he had done with Kabuto, one of three shinobi given the title by former Aimgakure warlord Hanzu the Salamander. Former teammates include Tsunade Senju and Orochimaru, trained by Haruzen Sarutobi, deceased Sandame Hokage of Konohagakure, author of Ika Ika and self-proclaimed super pervert. Jiraiya smiled. I am honored that my reputation precedes me. No, I just want to know who the major players are in the East, Naruto responded, causing Jiraiya's expression to soften. The movers and shakers, if you will. Wouldn't you agree, old man, that information is a valuable commodity? I assume the Hyuga and the Inoshika Cho informed you about myself and Konoha. Jiraiya inquired. We confirmed Hayashi Hyuga and his nephew, which means you were the one who made the asylum offer. They confirmed what we already knew, Naruto said. Like the fact that the shinobi accompanying you, who I can identify from previous encounters with the Leaf are Kakashi Hatake, Asuma Sarutobi, Sakura Haruno, and Sasuke Uchiha. The one with the giant dog is Kiba Inuzuka, son of Tsum Inuzuka. The silent one with the glasses is Shino Aburame. And the pale-skinned one is Sai. But I'm not familiar with these three. Please enlighten me. We are the elders of Konohagakure no Sado, Danzu introduced himself. My name is Danzu Shimura. Hanmura continued to introduce himself. My name is Hanmura Maitakado. And my name is Koharu Yudatane, Koharu concluded. We've come to represent the Goddamn Hokage, Tsunade Senju, the people of Konohagakure no Sado, and the Lord of Fire Country, Jiraiya explained. We have come to speak to both you, Lord Emperor and Lady Empress, in good faith. Go on, Hinata said, her voice muffled by her chakra. Both Konoha and Fire Country, as well as both of you, have an interest in the unified West. Jiraiya began. According to the Pekara merchants, you two were only teenagers when you decided to unify the lands, which is a commendable feat. Sasuke decided to speak at that point. HM, 2 years to unify the lands. If it had been me, I would have finished it in less time. Being a Uchiha, an elite, looks like his ego is still as big as Tears Point, Naruto remarked, cocking one brow. The guards on duty appeared amused. Jiraiya appeared to want to strangle Uchiha if Asuma didn't beat him to it first. Claiming such a title without the ability to back it up is very dangerous in these parts. Uchiha, Naruto countered, his gaze fixed on the last Uchiha from his seat. They don't last long here in the West. Here, we prove ourselves through actions, not words. Here, respect is earned, not given because of what clan you're from or what bloodline you wield. Sasuke began to retort, but Kakashi's hand on his shoulder, as well as Jiraiya's glare, stopped him. Before deactivating the Sharingan, Sasuke grunted. Try teaching the Uchiha some tact, Naruto remarked dryly. I'm sorry for my student, Kakashi said. As I was saying, Jiraiya continued, Major Minazuki was kind enough to give us a tour of the capital, and I can say on behalf of the envoy, and myself, we are very impressed with the Empire's methods. There is so much that the Unified West and the Leaf can share, provided that we can sign a political and military alliance between your Empire and Konohagakure no Sado. There is so much that we can learn. Naruto leaned back in his seat, one finger on his throne's armrest, as if considering agreeing to the proposed alliance. No, no, Jiraiya said again. No, Naruto said again. Being allied with the Leaf is not in the best interests of the Unified West, especially after what I learned from Suna representatives. What Gaara and the Sand Siblings told you is false, explained Kakashi. Konoha is the strongest of the Shinobi villages, with a strong will of fire among the people and many powerful Shinobi among our ranks. So ... the fact that Konohagakure rewards potential traitors while damning their potential heroes was false. Naruto inquired, observing Kakashi and Jiraiya stiffen slightly. That Konoha had lost every single alliance because they chose to side with a genin who willingly defected from Konoha for the promise of power over a loyal shinobi doing his job. How do you know? Sekura inquired. Naruto grinned. Jiraiya's information network is not the only spy network in town. Spring Country and Mist also verified your actions. But most of what I know about Konoha and its shinobi came from one person within my ranks, who I believe you know, as he was your former godson, Jiraiya, as well as Cell 7's former teammate, Naruto Uzumaki. Naruto stood there watching Jiraiya shift uncontrollably. Kakashi and the three elders both frowned. Sasuke was smug. So the Dobe is still alive. It makes sense that you'd have someone as frail as him fighting for you. Weak, replied the Emperor mildly. He is a Western hero. Takuma Uzumaki cautioned, be careful who you insult, little man. The Uzumaki take care of their own, he said, his gaze hardening on Jiraiya. And you ... you and the Goddamn betrayed my godson. Your nephew, Tsunade, was his great-aunt. And she chose the Leaf over blood. We believe in village loyalty, but family is also important. Calm down, Takuma, Naruto said. Takuma agreed. Do you know he's the Kyuubi reborn? Kakashi interjected. Did you know he's wanted in the bingo book for murdering my sensei and his wife, not to mention treason for causing harm to a clan heir? Funny, I thought Uzumaki was the heir to the clan, Naruto responded. His father was your village hero, and his mother was the former princess of Whirlpool. As for the charges of treason and harming a clan heir, those are false, because he was banished, which means you can't charge him with treason. Second, your precious Uchiha had willingly run off to join Orochimaru, and Uzumaki was simply following orders. That demon brat is no heir, Kakashi retorted angrily. He's just a fox in human clothing. No one notices the pulsing vein on Kurama's head, or the fact that her hand had formed a fist. It's obvious that, despite being a Yellow Flash student, you know nothing about Fuinjutsu, Naruto continued. The boy is a Jinchuriki, a jailer and warden, not a prisoner, and under the unified West, he is a powerful warrior, admired and respected by friend and foe alike, he said, pointing to Kakashi. Those who abandon the mission are trash, but those who abandon their comrades are lower than trash, Uzumaki says, for siding with a traitor and failing to provide proper tutelage to Uzumaki. You, Kakashi headache, are lower than trash. In my eyes, you and Sasuke Uchiha are scum. You dare to call me scum, snarled Sasuke as he activated his Sharingan. You and your whore are nothing in comparison to me. You both hide behind your valuable titles, while I am an elite among elite. That was all Sasuke could say before the Emperor and Empress consort disappeared. A fraction of a second later, the Uchiha prince felt the unmistakable touch of cold steel against his neck, as well as the second blade resting against his crotch, followed by a massive dose of killer intent so potent that it even froze Jiraiya and the others in place. Only the council, the present guards, and Kurama were unaffected. Impossible. Jiraiya fought as he knelt down. What strength? Both are faster than Minato. You call yourself an elite, but your Sharingan couldn't track our movements, Naruto deadpanned. His O katana against Sasuke's neck. I had hoped that our last encounter had humbled you, but now I see that it hasn't. Do you have any idea who you're dealing with? Spit out Sasuke. Do you? Retorted the Empress, her kukri pressed against the Uchiha's balls. Look where my husband and I are, and look at you, for all your talk of being elite, you are nothing more than a second-rate ninja hiding behind your family name and Dojutsu. You should know this, Sasuke Uchiha, Naruto continued. I can kill you right now, and my wife can kill you right now, you're nothing more than an insect that can be crushed under my heel, and you're really testing my patience. Keep your tongue in check or I'll remove it from your mouth, and I will take away what makes you a man, Hinata concluded. Hinata's meaning made Kiba, Kakashi, Asuma, Shino, and even the male elders wince. After delivering the threat, the Emperor and Empress of the Western Empire returned to their seats, lifting the killer intent with them. Regardless of what you think, Jiraiya said, you have confirmed that the Kyuubi Jinchuriki is here in the Unified West. He is a missing ninja and an S-class threat to both Konoha and Fire Country. With all due respect, I request that you turn him over to us so that he can face our justice. There's also the matter of two of the clan heiresses who had fled Konoha and come here with their families, Kakashi continued. Ino Yamanaka and Hanabi Hyuga, we demand on behalf of the Konohagakure High Council that they both be turned over to us so that they can be returned and married to Sasuke Uchiha as soon as possible. And we also request that you hand over Tenten and Anko Mitarashi, as they both fall under the CRA. The answer is no to surrendering Uzumaki to you, Naruto replied, revealing his killer intent. As for Yamanaka and the Hyuga, not to mention the other two, the answer is once again no, because I have granted them and their families political asylum as well as citizenship within the Unified West, and neither you nor Konoha are in a position to make demands of myself or my empire. Jiraiya puffed his chest out. You will be sorry, Lord Emperor, and you will not like having Konoha as an enemy. In any case, I would not want you or Konoha as allies, the Emperor responded. For your insolence, you will be sent back on the first ship back to the east. Thank whatever gods you worship that I do not send your bodies back to Konoha in 6 or 7 pieces, along with a declaration of war on your village and on Fire Country, Naruto added as Sasuke was about to retort. Kakashi put his hand over Sasuke's mouth. No, Sasuke, you've already gotten us into trouble, he hissed. Slow down, because he is your prize student. You should teach him some manners when he is in the presence of someone higher up, Naruto replied. Leave my sight, he said with a wave of his hand. 2 weeks later, Konohagakure no Sato. Jiraiya had dismissed Asuma Sarutobi, Sasuke Uchiha, and Cell 8 upon his return to Konoha, leaving himself, Kakashi, Sakura, and the two elders to face both Tsunade and the Fire Lord. Danzu left his compound, ignoring Jiraiya's request to stay with the others. Tsunade sends you examine the reports given to her by Sakura, Koharu, and Hinura inside the Hokage's office. The Fire Lord was also present, having taken a keen interest in Konoha's efforts to enlist the support of the Unified West. It's very interesting that their medical program employs both shinobi and samurai. Sakura added, it also confirmed what Captain Sarutobi said about their medic nins. As much as I hate to admit it, their healing methods far outstrip those of the leaf, and their combat medics are just as skilled, despite being samurai and not knowing any jutsu. Indeed, Tsunade murmured as she read the report. Acupuncture needles and shiatsu herbology most impressive, especially considering the Empress has created such a well-organized program for both shinobi and samurai. Their education and training is impressive, Fire Daimyo said as he read the reports of Koharu and Hanyura. The Empire employs both shinobi and samurai in his forces, and they can produce chunin and jounin faster than we can. Tsunade lowered the scroll. What happened? Did the Emperor and his wife agree to join us? Jiraiya raised his head. They refused to ally with us, and Sasuke's attitude and mouth didn't help matters either. Insulting both the Emperor and his wife, calling her a whore, and nearly losing his head and his balls. Tsunade fumed. That foolish boy. He almost started a war because of his ego. The Emperor and his wife showed plenty of restraint in not killing Sasuke where he stood, let alone castrate him, Kakashi seconded. And despite the both of them holding back most of their chakra, their power level is, for lack of a better word, insane. The Uchiha will be reprimanded for this offense, Tsunade said. He will be placed under house arrest and will not leave Konohagakure until I see fit. I second the motion, the Fire Daimyo said. The Emperor is an unknown, and that makes him even more dangerous. Sasuke Uchiha is becoming uncontrollable and has been ever since Uzumaki's banishment. He needs to be humbled. Lord Daimyo, we must treat the Uchiha with great care, Koharu said in Sasuke's defense. As he is the last loyal Uchiha of Konoha, we need the Sharingan. And yet, the Emperor, from what I found out, has a bloodline similar to that of the Six Path Sage, which makes the Sharingan obsolete, the Fire Daimyo replied curtly. I had pardoned him the first time when he tried to defect from Konoha. I will not be as merciful should he try to defect a second time. To Jiraiya and Kakashi, he said, continue. We have confirmed not only does the Emperor has the Rinnegan, but he did reveal to us one key bit of information regarding Naruto Uzumaki, reported Kakashi. Tsunade leaned forward in her chair. Please tell me that the brat is dead. Jiraiya raised his head. No, according to the Emperor, Uzumaki is still alive, and he appears to have fought alongside the Emperor in the wars that united the continent. That means the brat could have learned how to control his demon from the Emperor, Danzu reasoned, or that he has learned how to fight more effectively from the Emperor despite our sabotaging his training at the academy, and Hadake not teaching him anything other than chakra control. He turned to Tsunade. If Sarutobi had given him to me to train, we could have avoided this a long time ago. Jiraiya continued, there's more, Tsunade. The Uzumaki clan is not extinct. Takuma Uzumaki was seen in the west. Impossible, the Uzumaki has vanished, Tsunade replied. I saw the reports, and the Uzumaki were wiped out. It appears that Kushina was not entirely truthful with us, the Toad Sage responded mildly. My guess is that she ordered Takuma to evacuate Whirlpool and take as many survivors as possible. Worse, the Uzumaki is one of the main clans in the Empire, which means that the clan has rebuilt and is more powerful than it was during the last Shinobi War. Hell, he's on the Emperor's staff as one of his advisors, and he knows what we did to his nephew, not to mention the fact that you are his great-aunt. I don't care what Takuma thinks, Tsunade said flatly. He should hand Naruto over to us so we can finish what Minato started. Or better yet, he should kill the brat himself. So, what are we going to do about the Kyuubi brat? Koharu inquired. We know he's somewhere in the west. We should at least try to find him using the ANBU. Daimyo, the Fire, shook his head. No, if the Emperor discovers that we were responsible for such an act, given Uzumaki's reputation, he could declare war not only on Konoha, but also on the entire Fire Country in retaliation. We can't just sit here and do nothing, pleaded Koharu. If the Kyuubi brat is in the Emperor's good graces, he might turn his attention to us next. Only if we provoke him, replied Daimyo. That means don't provoke anyone from the west who comes here, especially those from the Picara merchant house. And Sasuke Uchiha is not to say anything about what happened in the unified west, under threat of permanent expulsion from the shinobi forces and the sealing of his Sharingan. Am I clear? The assembled ninja nodded, and Kakashi vanished to find his student and inform him of the Fire Lord's edict. Below Konohagakure no Sado, Tsunade reprimanded Sasuke for his actions in the west, Koharu said as she, Danzu, and Hanyura walked through Danzu's underground complex. Sai remained in the shadows of the trio. As of now, the Uchiha is under house arrest and is unable to leave the village. Tsunade is aware that Sasuke is under my jurisdiction. Danzu responded. Only I have the authority to determine his punishment. Unfortunately, she has the Fire Lord's support, Hanyura said. Which means his authority supersedes yours. Danzu reasoned, the Emperor and his council should have agreed to the alliance. Tato Matsukami should have ensured it. Could it be the Rinnegan's power? Furthermore, the Uzumaki clan resides. The Emperor has declined to join us, Hanyura explained. So, what do we do now? There's no getting around it, Danzu said. If the Empire refuses to join us, it is a threat to the Leaf. If the Empire decides to join our enemies, that is a risk that we cannot take. Like, Koharu began. Danzu described it as a decapitation strike. Cut off the head of the snake, and the body dies. The Empire is held together only by the Emperor and his wife. Remove them from the equation, and the Empire will revert to its warlike state. At the same time, we kidnap some of the Empire's top prospects and bring them back here to strengthen the Leaf. If you do this, Hanmura said, eradicate the traitors to the Leaf and their heirs, because no one betrays Konoha. Takuma Uzumaki is also a threat, said Koharu. He, too, must perish. All right, Sai. The ink user took a step forward and knelt in front of the Warhawk. Who is Lord Danzu? Danzu took out a scroll. He closed it and handed it to his subordinate after several moments of scribbling. This is an S-class Black Ops mission for the good of the village. You will return to Kimmon with two squads of Rude NBU in 2 weeks. Your primary targets will be the Emperor, his whore, and the Imperial Council. Your secondary targets will be the four clan heads, the Hyūga, the Inoshika Cho, and their heirs. Finally, you will eliminate Takuma Uzumaki. Sai gave a nod. I understand, Lord Shimura, your will be done. At the Red Lotus in 2 weeks later. It's 12 a.m. in the Imperial Capital. Sai was making final preparations for his mission inside his room at the Red Lotus Inn. It had taken 2 weeks of covert planning. But he and the two Rude NBU squads who had arrived disguised as tourists from the east were primed and ready to strike at the heart of the Imperial Nation. Unfortunately for Sai, the innkeeper recognized him from his previous encounter with Jiraiya and the Konohagakure envoy, and informed his wife. Fu had delivered word that Sai had returned minutes before. The innkeeper began to report an increase in visitors from the elemental countries, which triggered an automatic red flag to the Imperial Council. Naruto reacted quickly when it became clear that Danzu had sent Sai and a hit squad of Rude NBU to assassinate the senior Imperial hierarchy. As Sai completed his preparations, one squad of the Demon Brigade led by Haku, while the second squad of Hellcats led by Yujiro Nai, intercepted the would-be assassins, incapacitated them, and had them brought to the Imperial complex for further questioning. Naruto would deal with the ink user himself now that Sai's hit squad was incapacitated. The ink user's preparations had been interrupted by a gentle knock on Sai's door. He walked over to his door and opened it, curious as to who would be there at this time of night. And found himself in the presence of the Emperor of the United West. Hello, Sai, Naruto said flatly. Wham! Naruto's fist bouncing off Sai's skull caused him to fall like a sack of potatoes. Naruto stepped to the side, allowing three Hellcats to enter the room. After Sai was properly restrained and searched, one of the Hellcats began searching Sai's belongings and came across the mission scroll. Chief, I discovered something, she said, handing Naruto the scroll as Haku and Yujiro approached the Emperor. The entire Rude NBU has been restrained, Yujiro said. What exactly is it? Naruto replied, a hit list. And Hinata and I are at the top of the list, he said, closing the scroll and turning to face Haku. Haku, go to North Kimmon and bring me Hayashi, Hanabi, and both generations of the Inoshika show. I need them at the Imperial Complex in no less than 15 minutes. They must be aware of what is going on. Haku nodded and dashed off to do his duty. Minutes later, the Imperial Complex. Hayashi was irritated when he was awakened from his sleep. But neither were the Inoshika Cho or their descendants. However, Haku stated that it was urgent and had something to do with all of them. The four clan heads and their children were taken aback when they arrived at the Imperial Complex. There were 20 bound shinobi in the courtyard. Anyone in Konoha recognized them as ANBU members, especially those from Danzu's private security corps. Yujiro's Hellcats stood guard, blades drawn, ready to kill the intruders. Kurama had taken on the form of a fox, about the size of a horse, her 9 tails flailing lazily in the air. She was sitting on her haunches, but she was keeping a close eye on what was going on. Last but not least were Naruto and Hinata, who were conversing with Binisato, Takuma, and several members of the council. Hinata had seen her father and the others arrive and had pulled her husband away from and the others. You came, which is good, Naruto said. He motioned to Sai and the restrained Rude NBU. Do you recognize these men? They belong to Danzu's Rude NBU, he said, pulling out the mission scroll and tossing it to Shikaku. This was on Sai. Hayashi, Inoichi, and Chuza all crowded in around Shikaku to read the scroll after the lazy Nara head opened it. Hayashi raised his head in disbelief. This is a hit list, he said, his face contorted. Very troublesome, Shikaku commented. It comes from the three council elders, and it includes the Emperor and his wife, Takuma Uzumaki, the Imperial Council... and us. Ino's pupils dilated. That old jerk tried to kill all of us, she murmured. I believe the Hokage, Jiraiya, and the council are unaware of this black ops. The blood and the motive are in your hands, Nara, Naruto said. I wouldn't be surprised if they penned it in snake venom, he said, turning to Binosato and saying, no offense. Binosato gave a mocking smile. There were none taken, chief. My guess is that neither the perv nor the hag are aware of this. But I need to be certain before I plan my next move, Naruto explained. He looked at Inoichi. Both of you are awake. Inoichi and his daughter both nodded and approached Sai, who was struggling. The seals on his tongue prevented him from discussing Konoha, but he was helpless against Yamanaka's mind jutsu. He was quickly restrained by two Hellcats, rendering him helpless. After taking a deep breath, father and daughter each raised one hand and placed it on Sai's head, and they witnessed everything. Tsunade has reprimanded Sasuke for his actions in the West, and the Uchiha is currently under house arrest and cannot leave the village. Tsunade understands that Sasuke is under my jurisdiction, and only I can decide on his punishment. Unfortunately, she has the Fire Lord's support, which means his authority supersedes yours. Now that the Emperor has refused to join us, what do we do? There is no way around it. If the Empire refuses to join us, it is a threat to the Leaf, and if the Empire decides to join our enemies... that is a risk we cannot take. For example, a decapitation strike. Cut off the head of the snake, and the body dies. At the same time, we kidnap some of the Empire's top prospects and bring them back here to strengthen the Leaf. If you do this, then you must eliminate the traitors to the Leaf and their heirs, because no one betrays Konoha. Takuma Uzumaki is also a threat, and he, too, must die. All right, Sai. Who is Lord Danzu? This is an S-class Black Ops mission for the good of the village. You will return to Kimmon with two squads of Rude Anbu in 2 weeks. Your primary targets will be the Emperor, his whore, and the Imperial Council. Your secondary targets will be the four clan heads, the Hyūga, the Inoshika Cho, and their heirs. Finally, you will eliminate Takuma Uzumaki. I understand, Lord Shimura, you will be done. Inoichi and Ino, shocked and horrified, broke the jutsu and snapped his hand back. Inoichi moved his gaze to Naruto and Hinata. Danzu and the two elders, he said quietly. They ordered our deaths, and they wanted to kill us all. In the meantime, Ino fought the urge to vomit. That's all I need to hear, said Naruto. Hinata looked at Haku. Take them to Zabuza, Anko, and Ibuki, she said in a cold voice, as Naruto handed him a second scroll detailing how to remove the seals on the root's tongues. Four of them are more than enough for interrogation. Execute the rest. Tell them that for these four, the kid gloves are off, nothing is off limits. In a Kimmon bar and grill, Zabuza Mamichi and Ibuki Morino came to a halt in the middle of their drinks. Is it just me, or do I have this sudden urge to kiss the Empress consort full on the lips? Zabuza inquired. Yeah, Ibuki agreed. All of a sudden, it feels a lot like Christmas. Anko Mitarashi came to a halt in the middle of a bite at a nearby dango stand. As she found herself enjoying her job with the Imperial Interrogation and Torture Unit, a psychotic smile crept across her lips. Returning to the Imperial Complex, Naruto turned to Sai and bent low enough to whisper into his ear before Haku took them away. Remember this day, Sai, remember in the little time you have left that you attempted and failed to kill Naruto Uzumaki. Sai's eyes widened like saucers. Was the Emperor the Kyuubi Jinchuriki? Was the last thought he had before being taken away. So, what do we do now? Hayashi inquired. Naruto shifted his gaze to his father-in-law. I believe I should pay a personal visit to Konoha. Not to be a downer, Chief, Shikamaru said, but you're not one of Tsunade's favorite people. You have forgotten who I am, Shikamaru, Naruto responded. I am the unpredictable one, and since the old hag is not responsible this time, I'll leave her out of this, he said, his face darkening. Sarutobi's two teammates have outlived their usefulness, I'll see to that personally. They made a mental note for Hayashi, the three clan heads, and their heirs. Take note, do not offend Naruto or Hinata. Ever, 1 week later, Konohagakure no Sato. Koharu and Hinata had returned to their separate homes after meeting with Danzu. When asked about the Kimmon mission, Danzu replied that Sai had not returned word of its status, but the Warhawk was unconcerned. Sai was one of his best operatives, and the Rude Anbu who had accompanied him were the cream of the crop. Danzu was confident that Sai would complete his mission to decapitate the Imperial hierarchy. Hinata arrived home first. He had lived in Konoha's residential district, 5 houses down from Koharu, in a modest 2-story home. Following the Konoha exodus, he decided it was time for a change in living quarters. He was set on the Nara Ranch, but the Hyūga compound piqued his interest. Hinata entered his house as midnight approached. Inura could sense something was wrong despite not being a shinobi for decades. Either that or he was becoming paranoid in his old age. Naruto Namikaze observed his prey from the shadows. He'd arrived in Tanzuka Town, far enough away from Konoha, using the Demon's Gate Jutsu. Rather than using a henge to disguise himself, Naruto wore an ANBU uniform stolen from one of the rude ANBU who had attempted to kill him alongside Sai. He wore a kitsune mask to hide his face this time. It was simple to infiltrate Konoha. Konoha's security was extremely lax, as they had grown complacent in their abilities. He considered killing both Sasuke and Hatake, but decided against it. Sasuke was still useful, and Zabuza wanted to take Kakashi's head for himself, so he decided to take a look around town. He spied on his former cellmates, the Shinobi Council remnants, and civilians using the Rinnegan. He was not aware of any genjutsu. Even Jiraiya and Tsunade showed no signs of being under genjutsu. He hid inside the Namikaze estate as night fell, the seals allowing him access because he was of the Namikaze line. To pass the time until his personal mission, he reinforced the seals so Jiraiya couldn't break them. Naruto began his mission with his father's home secure and the clock approaching midnight. Hanmura had sealed his fate by entering his home. Naruto knew he had to make his death appear to be the result of an accident or natural causes, or else Tsunade and the others would suspect something was wrong. He was aware of Koharu's heart condition and had already taken care of her. Hanmura, on the other hand, chose a more straightforward approach. Hanmura started climbing the stairs to his home's second floor. Imagine his surprise and horror when, as he approached the second floor landing, a kitsune-masked ANBU appeared from the shadows, grabbed him by the shirt, and had him hanging on his tiptoes over the stairs, the only thing keeping him from falling to his death being the ANBU's iron grip on his shirt. Naruto removed the kitsune mask with his other hand, allowing the elder a clear view of his face. "Do you recognize me now, Mitakato? It's been 6 years since I was exiled." Hinmura's eyes widened. "You, Uzumaki," he exclaimed. "You can call me Emperor," Naruto replied, enjoying the elder's terrified expression. "Oh, yes, I know about Danzu's little plot to have myself killed, along with my wife, the council, my uncle, and the clan heads who defected, and I also know that you and Koharu supported this little scheme." "Don't worry, Koharu will be joining you in death soon enough," Hanmura begged. "Naruto, please, and sorry we did the best we could." "I know you're sorry, councilman," Naruto said as his gaze shifted to the Rinnegan. But let's pretend you aren't for the sake of argument." Naruto let go of Hanmura, who fell backwards, screaming as he went down the stairs. When Naruto heard the unmistakable sound of a neck snapping, the scream stopped. The now-dead councilman landed on the first floor in a mangled heap. Naruto examined the body as he walked down the stairs. Hanmura was no longer alive, his neck twisted at an unusual angle. If the broken neck did not kill him, the pool of blood pooling around his head most certainly did. One down, Naruto thought as he put on his kitsune mask and disappeared through Shunshin. Minutes later, Koharu's home. Koharu Yudaten sipped her tea at her table. Jasmine Petal was her favorite, and had been since her days on Team Tabarama. She was concerned because Sai had not communicated or returned from the West, despite the fact that he was supposed to have returned days ago. Koharu was always a realist, even more so than Danzu and Hanmura in some cases. She had always thought that Konoha was the most powerful of the Shinobi villages. She also believed that the elders should rule the leaf and that the position of Hokage should be abolished in the majority of cases. The Hokage would not be abolished, but he would be more of a figurehead. The only issue was that Tsunade was gaining power and influence within the council. She kept sipping her tea as an ANBU and a kitsune mask emerged from the shadows. Koharu wasn't concerned because she assumed the ANBU was one of Danzu's pets, and that if the root was inside her house. Danzu had an update on the Kimin mission. "Do you mean Danzu sent you to give me an update on the mission into the Empire?" Koharu inquired. She was taken aback when the ANBU pulled up a chair and sat across from her. "No," the ANBU replied before removing his mask and revealing his face to Koharu. Koharu's pupils dilated. The ANBU in front of her resembled Minato Namikaze, but with Kushina Yuzumaki's hair color. Her eyes narrowed slightly before widening as she realized who was sitting across from her. "Yuzumaki, Naruto. You old bitch, the one and only," Naruto replied. Koharu sipped her tea further. "So you decided to come out after Sai and the rude ANBU murdered your beloved emperor," snorted Koharu. "Is that it, demon? Some misguided vengeance. You'd think that, wouldn't you?" said Naruto. "For the record, Sai was unsuccessful in his quest, and the emperor is still alive. So you've met him." "I should," Naruto said, his gaze shifting to the Rinnegan. I am the Emperor, and Hinata Hyuga is my wife, Yuta Tensei's. Koharu put the puzzle pieces together, trying to conceal her surprise that the demon of Konoha was the most powerful man in the West. The clan heads and their children were granted asylum through your wife. That, and the fact that, of all the clans in this village, the Hyuga and the Inoshika Chōtryō saw me as what my parents wanted the entire village to see me as, a hero. Their children do not see me as a demon, and by granting them asylum into my empire, I am simply repaying them for their kindness toward me. So sigh failed, Koharu murmured as she sipped her tea calmly. What happens now? It's simple, Naruto replied. I came here to witness your demise. Strange words, demon brat, Koharu retorted angrily. You kill me, and then what? You're not going to make it out of Konoha, let alone Fire Country, she coughed. Tsunade will take care of it. Naruto responded, the old hag can't see past her sake bottle. As for the killing part, I did that 30 minutes ago before I paid your teammate a visit. Koharu's eyes blinked. She then felt pain in her chest. She began to gasp for air, the teacup falling from her grasp and smashing on the floor. Her coughing became increasingly violent, to the point where she was coughing up blood. She stumbled to her feet and began to walk around the room, while Naruto sat calmly in his chair. Do you feel the pain in your chest? Naruto mocked. The shortness of breath and the sense of impending doom. You met my captain of my elite guard back in Kimmon. The Minazuki clan also specializes in various types of poisons. Binisato was more than happy to assist in my personal mission. You... bastard, exclaimed Koharu. The poison is also untraceable and will leave your system when you die, Naruto added. Given your previous medical history with your bad heart, your death will be written off as heart failure. Oh, and don't worry about your precious Uchiha. I won't kill him... yet. He still has a use for me. He will be the catalyst for Konoha's destruction. Koharu cried out as she collapsed, her body twitching violently before collapsing, the death rattle escaping her lips. Give my regards to Haruzen, Naruto deadpanned as he retrieved and reapplied his mask. 2 points. Below Konohagakure, Danzu Shimura made his way through the corridors of his underground root compound. Danzu retired deeper into his underground chambers after dismissing both Koharu and Hinura. He had the same worries as Koharu and Hinura, but he wasn't as concerned as they were. Sai was his best man, and he had never let him down. He had considered sending Sasuke to lead the mission, but decided against it. He had grand plans for his Uchiha that involved Konoha. What a shame, Danzu thought as he made his way to his office. The Empire would have been an excellent ally for the Leaf. It's a shame they didn't come with us. However, this must be done to ensure that they do not join our enemies. Sai will not let me down. He has no idea how to fail. When he walked into his office, he was met with a terrifying sight. Sai's head lay on his desk, bloodied and pale, eyes gouged out, tongue ripped out, face locked in a mask of eternal pain. The cane clattered to the floor as Danzu stumbled forward several steps, then fell to his knees as the totality struck him full force. Sai had died, as had his most devoted root operative. Danzu realized he couldn't move at that point and looked down to see he was on an advanced-looking seal. WH, what is this? Isn't it magnificent? Fuinjutsu is a very interesting art, wouldn't you agree, old man? Naruto emerged from the shadows, still dressed as an ANBU, the kitsune mask covering his face, Rinnegan active, and in one hand, the tipless Tanto the ANBU used as their primary weapons. Danzu recognized the Rinnegan in the eyes. The Emperor. Got it in one, Shimura, Naruto said, motioning to the seal on which Danzu was standing. Just because I am a leader does not mean that. Unlike you, who lead from the shadows and believes that all shinobi are tools, I can get my hands dirty. If I may be so modest, I designed that seal. The seal is intended to drain your chakra and nullify any dejutsu, offensive and defensive seals, and bloodline-based abilities you have on your person. The more you resist, the worse it will be. To summarize, your mission was a failure. My wife and I are both still alive. The council is still alive and well. Takuma Uzumaki is still alive and well. Oh, and the four clan heads and their heirs are still alive, he said, motioning to Sai's head. Removing the seal from Sai's tongue was fairly simple. He and the three other root ANBU we kept alive for interrogation purposes gave us some pretty useful information... Well, that and where you keep your dirty little secrets, Naruto said, holding up a black book that detailed all of Danzu's previous crimes. I know you and Sarutobi's former teammates planned this small mission. Mitakato and Yudatane paid with their lives for this offense, Naruto continued, a broken neck with a cracked skull for Hinura and a heart attack for Koharu. Terrible business. I also know you have a Sharingan behind those bandages, and that you tried to use it to persuade the council to agree to the alliance with Konoha, Naruto continued. Like I said, Fuinjutsu is a very interesting art, especially when used to repel Jinjutsu. He tapped at the fake arm hidden inside his robes. How would your little Uchiha pet and the old hag of a Hokage react if they discovered you stole their clan's respective bloodlines? By the way, I destroyed your reserves. Do you realize what you've done? Danzu grumbled angrily. I also know you conspired with the Uchiha in their attempted coup. But when Itachi informed Sarutobi that forced your hand, Naruto continued. I also know that during the last war, you sold out the Uzumaki clan and Whirlpool to her adversaries. It's a good thing the Yondame's wife didn't trust you, because the Uzumaki fled west. You were also involved in a plot with Hanzu the Salamander and Dodo Kazahana. The devil's hands have been extremely active. I can just as easily kill you for your crimes as I did the other two. I can do to Kohona what you tried to do to my empire. I can kill Godaim, that super pervert teammate. I could easily execute the Konoha Council and eliminate the Shinobi clans and their heirs. Better yet, I could summon Naruto Uzumaki and unleash the Nine Tails on this village. But I'm in a good mood, so I'll spare them for the time being because they're innocent. Your life will also be spared so that you can testify. Konohagakure no Sato will fall into my hands, he said, pocketing Danzu's Black Ops book. In the meantime, I'll keep this to make sure you don't say anything. So pay attention, and pay attention well. If you or any other leaf attack my homeland, people, or interests, I will return with my army. Naruto rose to his feet and exited the office, but not before incinerating Sai's head with a flame jutsu. 30 minutes later, the seal that held Danzu in place was gone, and the old warhawk collapsed onto the ground. Naruto was long gone, having used the demon's gate jutsu to safely return to the empire. Later that day, inside the council chambers, Tsunade announced the deaths of both Koharu Yudaten and Hanmura Maitakado, removing Danzu's top two supporters. But his hands were tied. If he told Tsunade what he knew, the emperor would literally unleash hell on Konoha. Before that, Tsunade and Sasuke would both kill him for stealing their bloodlines.
I will continue this story next part. Till then, we weave offline.